Right. Well, the approach I started with was looking at, you know, the standard model fiber bundle, including all the fermion, each fermion as a fiber, and all the gauge fields as their principal bundles, with their Lie groups being their fibers over a, you know, smooth space-time base, and having that whole structure be embedded inside the Lie group, the E8 Lie group itself, as an embedding of smooth structures with another, and then using the root system to describe this.
Yeah.
Since you can't describe these high-dimensional things
right.
in any sane way, but use the root system to describe it.
Right.
But what you guys are using is using the root systems directly, corresponding to space-time, and I'm not sure how the fibers are going to come out in some natural way.
Yeah, because it's constantly refreshed. So it's a lot like loop quantum gravity. You know how they overlay spin networks?
Yeah.
That's, you could think of this as the full space of states, you could say, is that the cut window they have. So it's rendering the crystal over and over. And these are, you could consider those as overlaps. That's a lot like loop quantum gravity. It's kind of gives you that Hilbert space for, you know how it's uncountable? Typically some people say it's uncountable. There's so many overlaps. This will have a countable number of
seen the loop quantum gravity description of gauge fields, other than by enlarging the...
This will have discretized fibers that should give you this internal symmetry, and plus this dynamically generated tetrahedral quasi-crystal.
So Marcelo, who's going to be here back in a week, but... He's our guy who has some training in loop quantum gravity. He's a quantum field theorist. And what he's working on is a rigorous mapping of the transformations of the discretized Hope fibers into the projective space, where you discretize them in the higher dimensional space on, say, a Gossett polytope, and then you discretize the one spheres themselves as the points that are coincident. So now you then take that, you project that down to the lower dimensional space, and your points on fibers that used to be on one fiber can get rearranged into different families in the projective space. So what Marcelo wants to do is rigorously map that so that we can use hot fiber, discretized hot fiber theory from the higher lattices and then map it down into this.
So you have not only discretized space-time, but discretized fibers as well.
Yes.
Oh, boy.
Because, well, if...
It's going to be a neat trick if you can build the standard model this way.
Yeah, it'd be super cool, yeah. Pierre likes it because it's a way to get from 8D to 4D.
Mm-hmm.
That's, so he's thinking, okay, the interactions are happening up here, but we don't perceive 8 dimensions. So that's why he wrote a paper on mapping it down so he can actually see what's happening. But perhaps the scattering, of course, is way easier in 8D when you're doing it Pierrot's way. So you just have the commutators hitting each other. But down here in the quasi-crystal, you have all kinds of dynamics.
Right.
Yeah.
There's nothing else.
Many of my physics colleagues will say that mathematics describes our physical reality, at least in some approximate sense. I go further and argue that it actually is our physical reality.
Told us light was a wave. So now let's fire photon particles one at a time at the slits. What happens is that for each photon, the detector registers a hit on the back screen at a single point. And at first, with a small sample, the hits seem random. But over time, we see that the interference pattern re-emerges. Here's a video of the detector plate. It's as if each photon was contributing to the interference pattern, even though there wasn't another photon to interfere with. So, the conclusion is that photons interfere with themselves. Turns out that they only interfere with themselves. They never interfere with another photon. Now look what happens if we detect which slit the photon went through. Here, a detector registers, yes, if the photon went through the upper slit, and no, if it didn't. The detector sees a photon coming through the top slit around half the time. We assume that if a photon went through one of the slits, and it was not the top slit, then it must have gone through the bottom slit. Here's the resulting pattern. But this is the pattern for particles. If we turn off the detector, we get the pattern for waves again. This duality this day. A good way to look at it is light propagating through space as a wave. But at any time it interacts with something, it interacts as a particle. In other words, it is created as a particle and absorbed as a particle, but travels through space as a wave. So it's important to remember, electrons in an atom do not orbit the nucleus. They are not like planets around the sun. They exist as stationary standing waves. So physicists climbed mountains and went up in balloons with their cloud chambers hunting for new particles. Here's what radiation looks like in a cloud chamber. The atmosphere in the chamber contains a vapor of alcohol. When charged particles move through the atmosphere, they cause little droplets to form. These are the cloud tracks that we see. It works on the same principle as tracks forming behind high-flying jet aircraft. In 1928, 4 years before Anderson discovered the positron, Paul Dirac predicted the existence of antimatter and proposed that all particles had antiparticles and that they would annihilate each other if they came into contact. The positron is the antiparticle of the electron. Here's an event in the cloud chamber that shows the creation of a pair of particles, one electron and one positron. This event was the conversion of a high-energy gamma ray that kicked an electron out of an atom and was itself converted into two particles. Now's a good time to review the particle sizes we've seen so far. In our first segment, we used an electron microscope to see a carbon atom with a diameter of 0.14 nanometers. That's a million times smaller than the width of a human hair. In our second segment, we probed the atom with alpha particles and found that the nucleus was very small compared to the atom. Here we have the carbon nucleus at around 26,000 times smaller than the carbon atom. The simplest nucleus is hydrogen's. It's just a proton. Its diameter is 78,000 times smaller than the carbon atom. In this segment, we probed the proton with high-velocity electrons and found that it had three components called quarks. Powerful accelerators and hadron colliders have put the upper limit on the diameter of the cross-section of quarks at 1 times 10 to the minus 18 meters. That's 1,760 times smaller than a proton, and 140 million times smaller than a carbon atom. This is also the upper limit for the cross-section of an electron. The neutrino is the smallest elementary particle, with a cross-section that is 1,000 times smaller than an electron or quark. That makes it 140,000 trillion times smaller than the diameter of a human hair. In an atom. For example, a beam of photons can be made to have the same quantum state. This is how a laser works. On the other hand, the inability of electrons to fit into the same quantum state creates an outward pressure that halts a star's collapse. Our very idea of what a proton looks like has now shifted from a point particle to a three-part particle to a whirlwind of elementary particle activity. In fact, it is very difficult to distinguish between the disturbances that represent virtual particles and disturbances that represent actual particles in a plasma like this. But for our purposes, we can view a proton as a cloud of gluons holding three quarks together. The proton is key to helping us understand the origin of mass. The only stable elementary particles in the proton with mass are the two up quarks and one down quark. Their tiny masses constitute only 1% of the mass of the proton. 99% comes from the energy of the fields and motion of the moving parts, following the famous E equals mc squared formula. So it is quite accurate to say that confined energy is the origin of mass. We'll bring this point home when we get to the Higgs boson. Protons and neutrons. As the distance between quarks grows to the diameter of a proton, the strength of the force approaches 18 tons. Imagine 18 tons focused on such a tiny spot. This makes it virtually impossible to separate quarks. All of space is filled with matter fields that can spawn fermion particles as waves. This includes all the leptons and the quarks. These particles carry one or more charges: color charge, electromagnetic charge, and weak hypercharge. Particles with a charge fill the space around them with a force field that can spawn force particles when excited by particles that carry their charge. These are the bosons. The bosons are the force carriers or mediators of all fermion-particle interactions.